Sometimes we hear these two gentlemen speak the majority of time when they come. They often refer to their female companions that are with them. And we think of Loretta, who is the daughter of my little buddy, Francois. He said to share with you the fact that his wife couldn't come but doesn't want him to travel unless someone is there to help guide him. And evidently she doesn't trust Walter, so Loretta must tag along and to help. And then we have Sonica, which is Walter's wife. And she is kind of not only the organizer to keep him organized, like he said, you know, he will schedule one thing in one country and another thing on the same day in a totally different country. She has to try to keep him straight. So we're going to ask them to come up here, and also if they want to bring their gentleman friend to tag along for support, that's okay as well. Or if they don't want them to come, they're trying to figure out what they're going to do here. I figure the ladies have stories that we may never, ever hear from the guys. And they might even tell us what these gentlemen are really like. You notice I didn't bring my wife up here. Here they come, bringing their own chairs. Oh, you're going to let them sit down, huh? I'll bring one more chair.
It's okay, we need two more. You can stay if you want.
I can stay. No, you might talk about me.
They can sit, we'll stand.
Okay.
Well, no, I'll bring another chair. There's the mic.
Please sit over there. I want to speak behind your back.
I want to tell you why I love Walter.
Don't talk about me. Talk about something better.
You will not tell me what to say. I was praying for a man like him, and I found him. And I got the manse in one of our towns, and I got it just an hour before the conference, rented out to somebody else. Made it. And then we got a sponsor for him that sponsored him for 1 year. I tell you this morning, he was down and out. So the first year we worked together. But the next year, he traveled a long way every evening to attend all the lectures I gave, and I gradually brought him in. You cannot bring a man in too fast. I never push people. I mean very hard. And he always had a car problem. So one day he comes along with an old cadet, about 50 years old. The wheels were falling off. He said to me, Francie, this thing has only got 40,000 kilometers. I said, Walter, this car was at the fountain of youth. But he sacrificed his time, his money, his effort, and the trials he received from my strange personality. He persevered. Every day I pray for him and his wife and his children. And I'm so glad to be his friend. He wants to proclaim the message, and he's got a passion. And this is what I pray. Do you like Walter? Can I see the hands of those who don't like him? So Walter, tell them about that cadet that stopped every evening at a certain spot.
People want to know what made me... Where are you going? Grab him and bring him back duly bound.
I don't need this. I've got my own. You can have it. You sing. People want to know why
We have such a weird ministry. And Francie, come here. Where's he go? There he is.
Sun.
So. It's the same word in English and in Afrikaans. It means sit. They want to know, why do I do these funny things? Why do I speak about secret societies? Isn't there something better to speak about? Why do you want to be so controversial? Why don't you just speak about Jesus? Isn't it the best thing you can do? Just speak about Jesus. And it's been tough speaking about all the things that I speak about, but there's a history, and I'll tell you a little bit about it. Why don't I just speak about Jesus? In fact, everything I say is about Jesus. If you take the Total Onslaught series, the total onslaught is against whom? It's against Jesus. Every single effort to dethrone Jesus. And the lies and the religions of the world and the deceived people. And I have a particular hatred for deception. Doesn't God say he hates sin? I'm not allowed to hate any person, but I may hate deception. And I hate it with a passion. I cannot even describe the passion with which I hate deception. I loathe it. There isn't an adjective to describe it. All those years, I was deceived into hating God because of a certain theology. Isn't that right? I was duped out of all that could have given joy. My youth was not the most pleasant of youths that anyone could have. No mother, a stepmother, which fits well into fairy tales. I was never allowed at home, wandering around from hostel to hostel to family member to family member. Until I found my first wife here. And then the deception got worse. Not through her doings, but when that Roman Catholic priest came and he did an exorcism in my home. And everything was perfect. And I thought, well, the power must lie with the church. But it was a lie. It was a deception. He cleaned up the place. He told his demons, stand back, so that I could be twice as trapped in a lie as I was before. Isn't that disgusting? And when I start tugging on the chain, he releases his demons again. And you had to rely on God to fill the void. But God doesn't force himself on anyone. It's a freedom of choice. And so you have to do that. And I discovered that this man had received his instruction because he phoned me just as we were coming Adventists. He phoned me and he said, Walter, you better get back. After a year, never heard of him for a year. You better get back to the Catholic Church immediately because you are causing great suffering to your father. My father was dead. My father was suffering in purgatory, according to him, for my disobedience. But I'd done a little Bible study by then, and I knew there was no purgatory. And I also knew about the state of the dead, but I played along and I said, well, that's interesting. How did you know that my father was suffering in purgatory? And he said, the nuns told him. I said, well, that's fascinating. How do the nuns know that my father was suffering in purgatory? And he said, the spirits told them.
So then I knew that they had seance-type meetings and that the spirit world was communicating to me. And this is nothing strange to me because my wife also had a mother who was an atheist, brilliant person, nice person, and I liked her a lot. But she also had a stepmother because her parents were divorced. And this lady was an occultist. She was the first one to introduce A Course in Miracles to Southern Africa. And she would have audiences just like the Witch of Endor had. So this is nothing unusual. Channeled information, direct channeling. This was new to me. It wasn't new to me. So I knew that this had been a deception. And I thought to myself, how many millions of people are there in the world that are deceived? Isn't that so? And I said to God, I hate deception. Help me to show the world that they must leave deception behind and come to truth. And that's where this ministry actually started. That was the basis. But God also had to show us that this is not some airy-fairy story as you have out there in the world. This is a real war. A real war. And my first experience of this real war was this battle over my child. But then when it comes to the proclamation of the message, we had, where do you think you're going? She'll come back, I know. Wasn't that campaign that we had in Paul? Now, I told the story in San Diego, but I'll tell it again, because there are many people here that didn't hear it. We did a campaign, he and I, in that town. And that's where we told the story. Remember, Pastor Bob, about the angel that released the...
Yes,
I'm not going to tell that story. But in this place, there was a man, and he was listening to the lectures, and he was interested in becoming a Seventh-day Adventist. And he had many questions. So one day, he phoned Francois. But Francois didn't answer, neither did his wife answer. He got a message on the other side, not a message, but somebody answering, a woman, with a horrendous laugh. And she answered the phone and she said to him, ha ha, I have him where I want him. And she screeched with laughter. And he got such a fright, he put the phone down. And he phoned me. And he said, do you know what's going on with Francois? Because I phoned him and there's this terrible woman on the other side screeching like a maniac. And I was scared. I didn't phone again. Can you find out what's going on there? So I said, well, sure, okay. So I phoned Francois. And guess what? The same woman answered the phone. And she laughed with this horrible laughter, real demonic. And she says, I've got him where I want him. I've destroyed him. He's finished. And then she roared with laughter that I had to take the phone from my ear. And my wife heard her. How far was she away? Were you away?
It was probably from here to the wall, that far.
And I got a fright, and I put the phone down. And I phoned again, thinking, did I get the wrong number? And I phoned again, and his wife answered, in tears. And I said, what's going on over there? And she says she doesn't know, but Francois is sitting on the floor and he's not getting up. You tell the story.
You know, we must have the Sanhedrin around. But sometimes there are people in the Sanhedrin that doesn't want certain individuals to say what they need to say. And I was battling with the Sanhedrin. You know who the Sanhedrin is? Yeah. The devil didn't want this man to do the work he's doing. And I had a very hard time to accommodate Walter, give him my pulpit, arrange into the lectures for him to speak. And, you know, he worked hard, and at a certain stage, like Jacob, I said to the Lord, everything is against me. And I just fell to the ground, and there I sat. But Walter comes to people who are down and out. Tell them what you did, Walter.
I've got my own. I'm very important. Anyway, we shoved those kids in the car and we climbed in the car and we drove. We were, what, 30 kilometers, 40 kilometers away? 50, okay. We drove there and there he was sitting on the floor. And we didn't know what to do with him. And he was so depressed. And that night he had to give a lecture. And then he has this propensity that his back jumps out. I think it's from all the heavy bags of concrete that he carries around and stuff. Oh, no. It must be something else. Anyway. His back goes out and then he locks. And he says, you should see him, how funny he looks then. He sits there. And that night, we carried him onto the stage. And he sat there behind the pulpit in this position. And as he preached, he came upright, etc., etc. That was an amazing campaign. It was an incredible campaign. That's where we met the Black Angel.
Tell them about the Black Angel.
No, but they've heard it in San Diego.
There's only 10 people from San Diego, and they want to hear some more detail. You can't punish these people because of San Diego.
We want to answer questions this afternoon. But we thought we'd just fill you in on some of the details and the anecdotes as to why this ministry was started. To dispel the idea that this is some bandwagon that somebody wants to climb on in order to be different from everyone else. This is not something we do because we think we want to be different. And there are many people in the world that have come into this church because of this weird ministry. Many people inside the church don't really understand it. Because they don't know the history, they don't know where we come from. And the biggest complainers are always from within our own ranks. And I always say to them when they say, why do you speak about all these evil things? Why don't you concentrate on the good things? I said, you're a Seventh-day Adventist? They say, yes. And I said, well, the series is not for you. Don't look at it. The series is for those who are outside, trapped in spiritism, trapped in occultism, trapped in Freemasonry, trapped in the nightmare of false religion. And the series is for them. It's not for you. I have one for you. It's called Total Transformation. It was just recorded. That's for you, Seventh-day Adventists. I couldn't say that then, but that's what we said in the past. Now I can say that. Yes, and so in this campaign, it was a first in many ways. It was the first time in Southern Africa that there was a multiracial campaign. Never happened before. We had apartheid. You couldn't go to the same toilet. You couldn't go to the same teller in a bank. You couldn't go to the same teller in a post office. And, I mean, you Americans know you have a similar history. Don't pretend that you were so great. You were just as bad. Isn't that so?
Sorry, let's be straight about it. But that's what it was like. But Francois and I, we decided we were going to speak publicly, and whosoever should come. But racial prejudice was running deep in the country. And at the end of the campaign, we started with 3 people and we ended with 60. Non-racial church, the first one in the whole of South Africa. And there was so much prejudice in the church. Black against white, white against black, and animosity and backbiting. It was like a hornet's nest in that church. And the devil had permitted also some people who were ultra weird in that respect to come into the church, and they were leavening with poison behind the scenes. And the idea was that these cultures had to be separated because they don't sing like us, they don't dress like us, they won't be able to do the same hymns as we, they were different language, they were, oh, 1,000 reasons. And he would preach in one church, I would preach in the other church, and we would swap over. And it was my turn to preach in this particular church where we held the campaign, and there was this animosity in the church. And as I was preaching, this black lady walks into the church, and all the eyes went, "Grung! What is she doing here?" Now, we actually didn't have any black people in that campaign. It was mainly colored people and white people, and the prejudice there was bad enough. Now imagine if it went one step further and there was an added dosage of pigmentation. That would cause a major crisis, because some people believe in salvation by pigmentation. Did you know that? And this woman walks in, and in her decorum and in her presence, she totally destroys their philosophy, because she's dressed immaculately. She has a Bible under the arm. Did she have a hymnal, Sonika? No hymnal. Give it to her.
No hymnal.
Where were you sitting?
I was sitting at the back.
Why don't you sit in the front of the church like you should?
No.
You were sitting in the back, right?
I was sitting in the back, and she came and sat one row before me, in front of me, and yes, that's it.
She's very shy. We have to coax her.
All right, she was sitting in front of me, and I noticed she was, every time the hymn was announced, she would sing every word, every verse off by heart. She had, it was not a word that she missed. And every time the Bible text was announced, she would open the Bible within seconds. I was still searching, and she would open it within seconds.
I was preaching and I was watching her. And they had said, "They won't be able to sing our hymns." She sang them clear as a bell. Her voice was above the others. It was not in a different nuance or in a different cultural setting. It was absolutely perfect. She totally obliterated their philosophy. And after the sermon, being the one who gave the sermon, I go up the middle and I go and stand at the back and I greet them as they come out, right? Now I'm waiting for her because I want to ask her, "Why are you here? And how did you get here? Because there are black churches. Why didn't you go to one of the black churches? Why did you come to this church?" There she is. And everybody came out, but she wasn't there. So I said to my wife, "Where is she? Where is she?" "Well, she must still be inside. There's nowhere else to get up." And we searched and she was not there. So there was an angel. So prejudice of any form is something that God is not in favor of, right? So we had the spiritualism, Every night when I went home after the meeting, my car broke down. And it was not because it was at the Fountain of Youth. Because it always broke down in exactly the same spot. Unless it had a memory. And I would have to wait for 10 minutes, 20 minutes, sometimes an hour in the middle of nowhere. And then all of a sudden the lights would come on the car and everything would work again and I could drive. It was always the same spot. So it was a very interesting training. And then one other thing. Do you remember, Francois? We split it then. You gave archaeology and you did a series. And I gave health a little bit later. And we started, and then we brought them together later. So it was like two campaigns in one place, and we're very deceptive. Nobody knew that we knew each other, right, Francois? So the one man attends his, and he's totally convinced this is the truth. And his wife is vindictive. With such venomous animosity, you cannot believe it. He went to visit them. She brought a tray with tea. She put it on the floor in the foyer and said, "There, I don't serve people like you. You can drink it off the floor." That's how she was. "I don't want your type in the house," she said to you. She wasn't very nice to you, huh? You're shaking your head. No, she wasn't nice. What else do you want to tell about her?
You went there.
No, I didn't go there again. Then later, I started with the health. She hadn't seen me, but she'd seen the advertisement, and this vindictive lady came to the house. I came to my lectures, and she was enthusiastic. And she went all the way through, and she accepted the message. And when she accepted the message, her husband said, "You were mean when I accepted it. You will not accept this message. If you go to them, I'll throw you out of the house." Yeah, so it turned it around. And so she went that night to bed, and he said, "Get up. You're not in my bed. Get up." And so she went out and she slept in the guest room. And there she lay, and she was very depressed. And then a little bit later, she heard her name called. What was her name? Forget it. Whatever. We don't have to mention names. She heard her name called. And she thought, he had a change of heart. So she went, but he was snoring. So she went back into the guest room, and she heard her name called. And she looked, and there was nothing. And then she thought, maybe, you know, it's family or something. She went to the window and looked outside. Nothing. And then she heard her name again. And she thought, "Is this God speaking to me?" And she said, "Yes." Because she was now battling. Is this the right thing to do? What about this commandment stuff and all of this? And then she saw two tablets of stone come down before her. And she realized, keep the commandment. And so she and her daughter were baptized. But the husband remained vindictive. But Francois has a way of dealing with these things. Do you remember what you said to him a couple of months later? Tell them.
You know, he came to a baptismal service. He was a big man like Pastor Bob. And
Didn't want to come inside.
After the service, he sat right at the back. After the service, he said, "Ew."
"No, you've got Alzheimer's. Listen here." He sat outside in the car. He wouldn't come into the church. It was a freezing cold day. And so you went outside to him and said to him, "Please come inside. It's warm inside." And you didn't want to. So you said to him, "Just sit in the back. I mean, you don't have to take part. At least it's warm." And then he came in. Now you continue.
Thank you, Walter. He sat at the back, and after the service, everybody was out. And he said, "You know, I should have been baptized." And I said, "Come with me. I don't like to drag people." And we dragged him up to the baptismal font, and I think Walter had to give him the last push. but they were baptized. There's nothing like spreading the word and seeing the change in the lives of people. Are the ladies going to say something?
Yes, I'm going to get to them now. Well, you gave it to your daughter. Perhaps she has something to say.
You know, I prayed for 9 years for this little thing to come along. And when she was born, she had respiratory, is that the word? Problems. And the pediatric came to me and he said, if she lives for 72 hours, that'll be a miracle, but just prepare yourself, the little infant is going to die. And I stood there at the incubator. Is that the right word?
That's the right word.
And I prayed for this little thing. She was so small. And I remember it was a Sabbath at 12 o'clock. I didn't go to church. I was praying next to her. And when 12 o'clock came, she had a normal way of breathing. And here she is. So she's a miracle. But now that I'm getting old, her mom says, you will not let your dad go alone. You must attend him. And tell them about what happened at Heathrow at Terminal 5.
Now he's getting me all emotional and I have to speak. Not because of age, but he seems to be forgetting things. But he says it has nothing to do with age.
He's been like that from the beginning.
So last year we were on Heathrow Airport on the way to Vancouver. And he has this one camera bag. And Matthew, Luke and Josh will know exactly everything about this camera bag. Because they've been so sweet, they've been looking after this bag like it's the only bag. Anyway, we were getting in, I was picking up the suitcases and we had to be in a hurry and I was trying to get both our cases in the... What's the dance
for now?
The train.
Yeah, train.
Into the train. And because of his back, I usually pick up the cases and I put them in. But I was a bit slow and I couldn't get them in quick enough. So he tried to help me. And with trying to help me to put these suitcases in, he left this very, very important bag with his laptop, with all his presentations on the laptop, with his passport and his air tickets. He put them down. And as we put our bags in the train, the doors closed and the train went off. So we just saw the bag and we sort of waved goodbye, not knowing if we'll find this bag again. And there was an official standing and she was looking at me. We had eye contact and I just showed her, phone me, not knowing where she'll get hold of me, but phone me. So we were praying so much. And when we got to Terminal 5, we asked the security if they knew anything about the bag and they said no, but we'll see what we can do. And after lots of prayers, we got the bag back with all his presentations, his passport and his air ticket. So that's why my mom commissions me to go with him to remember, to pack in everything, to remind him, do you have this and do you have that? And he sometimes comes out in the morning wearing a funny shorts with a jersey and a shirt, then I'd say, no, Dad, go back. Just go back and come out again looking different.
So when you ask me to come and serve you, sorry, but she's got to come along.
I want to just say something.
Just to say something about Walter and my dad. In Afrikaans, we have a word that means friend, but it's maiki. That means, you know, when you're a small kid, you would say, this is my best friend. So my dad's always saying, I come for my maiki kair, which means I'm going to visit my little friend, although he's not little. So just being together with these two guys since the 1st of May, it's marvelous to see how well they know each other. The one would start a sentence and the other one would just complete it. And they also speak in codes, and I have lost some of these codes along the way. And then they'd say these funny sentences that's totally not does it have anything to do with the conversation? And I'm thinking, what are they talking about? And then Walter would say, did you get that code? No, I didn't get this code. But one that we picked up now in Israel, if for those of you who has been to Israel and to the Western Wall, the Wailing Wall, you'll see the very committed Jews going back and forth like this. So Sonika and I, we were sitting in the first meetings in San Diego at the Wailing Wall. We were doing this. So every time somebody falls asleep, my dad or Walter would say, oh, they're at the Wailing Wall. So.
You must talk first.
All right. I want to tell you that God cares about the little things. God cares about your frame of mind. God cares about the questions in your head. God cares when you are lonely. God cares when you are sad. He takes care of all of those issues. Now, in most of our campaigns, I'm already... How do I say this? I'm petrified of campaigns. Because normally I know when I hold a campaign anywhere in the world, the devil's going to hit my wife. And I think one day she'll have five angels holding up her crown because her neck is a bit thin. And I'm a bit tempestuous, so I always say the Lord's going to put my crown on with a tweezer. But she's going to have five angels. And in many, many campaigns, whenever she has an operation, everything goes wrong. Everything goes wrong, you name it. And she's always on the point where they tell me she's not going to live. And she's always lying in hospital and I have a campaign. And I say, I'm going to cancel the campaign. And she always refuses that I cancel the campaign and has to get through it by herself. And once they told me, if you leave tonight, that's the last you will see of her. She's not going to make it. So I said, I'm staying. And she said, no, you will go. God's work comes first. And anyway, nou moenie bewoer raak nie. Nee, ek ook ek sal hê. In any case, after one of these operations where everything was wrong and she hemorrhaged and was just about gone, it took weeks for her to recover, but we were very poor. We couldn't afford something like a nurse or something to help. And we were new. Nobody really knew us in the church at that stage. I just had one little friend, this one, and he was 50 kilometers away. And I would have to prop her up in the bed. I would have to carry her to the toilet and help her do whatever she had to do. And she was so weak she couldn't move, so I had to prepare food and I had to make sure that I sneak away from work and come and take her to the toilet and take her, put her back into bed. And she would sit, for how many weeks was it that you had to sit?
Huh? Six weeks.
Yeah. 6 weeks she had to sit in bed and couldn't move by herself. And she was lonely and she was depressed and downhearted and everything was going wrong. And you tell them how God comforted you.
We were just speaking this afternoon about how much God loves animals and how the Lord used animals to be companions for... Oh, I'm emotional, I'm sorry. To be companions for human beings. And this was an experience that I really... don't know how the Lord did this, but it was an amazing experience. I was lying in bed, and he had left some bread and avocado and some fruit for me next to the bed. So I started to take my food and had my plate on my lap in the bed. And I heard something. Now, we had an Alsatian German Shepherd dog, and we had a cat. And the back door was always open so the animals could go in and come back, go out and come back in. And they were lying in the lounge and they were sleeping. And I heard this noise. It was a different noise, and I saw down the passage towards the bed, towards the bedroom, came a little squirrel. And the squirrel must have passed the dog and the cat, and the cat used to catch the squirrels and kill them. But the squirrel managed to come in, and it came right up to the bed. It hopped onto the bed, came up to the plate, and sat right opposite the plate and started eating my bread and my avocado. And when it finished, it walked off and it lay on the sofa on the seat that we had in the bedroom, and it slept in the sun for an hour, and then it went outside and it was gone. And this happened every single day. The next morning I was waiting and it came down the passage, ate my avocado and my bread, and it went and slept. And then it went outside, and this carried on for the whole 6 weeks that I was in bed. And eventually at the last day when I was allowed to go out, I went outside and I looked at the oak tree that we had in the garden, and it came down the oak tree and it came towards me, ran up my leg, onto my shoulder, down the other leg, and it went up into the tree, and we never saw it again. It had just come to say goodbye. And I think the Lord had used this little animal to show me that he really cares, and that if we think we are alone, he's like angels. They're there, but we don't always see them. And an animal can be used to comfort us. And, yeah, it was a good experience.
I'm trying to figure out why I'm up here.
You tell them the story of what happened to you. We want to hear from you.
Not even a part of this family.
Go for it. Well, this is not about us. This is about God.
That's true. That's true. I had a little country church in western Nebraska. And I was just getting ready to get up to preach a sermon when a young man walks in the back of the church. And he stops and he's looking around like, I don't know where to go. So I invited him to come in and to sit. I said, I'm just getting ready to preach a sermon, and I'd like to get acquainted with you afterwards. And so he sat and he listened to the sermon. When the sermon was over, I went over and introduced myself, and I asked him his name, and he said, my name is Sandy. And I said, Sandy what? He said, just Sandy. And I said, well, the ladies are fixing a meal. We'd like to have you stay with us, Sandy. I need to talk to my head elder for a moment, and then I'll come and join you, and I'll introduce you to some of the church members that are there. So Sandy went out, and I talked to the head elder. And as I was talking to him, I finished and I went out into the foyer. And normally after the sermon, we had a family where this one lady had four little kids under the age of five. And they were extremely hyperactive children. And they would just bounce off the wall and be crying and screaming after the sermons. But when I went out, I saw Sandy sitting on a couch, and the little kids were sitting next to him with their hands folded, as quiet as could be, never saying a word. And so I went over, and Sandy says, you know, I've got a message for you. Do you mind if I borrow a Bible? And so one of the elders gave him his Bible, and he says, I want to turn to, and he would say the name of the book of the Bible and the chapter and the verse, and without looking at it, he would turn to that Bible book, the chapter and the verse, hold it up, quote the verse, point it with his finger as it was leading across perfectly on the same verse. And he would go one right after another, after another, after another. And his message was the soon coming of Jesus. And he told the men, he says, you're the spiritual leaders of your family. You need to get your families ready because Jesus is coming soon. He ate with us, and then I walked Sandy to the door. And of all things, Sandy got on a Harley Davidson motorcycle. And he drove off and went around a corner, and I didn't see him as he went around a corner. But there were church members who had not been at the church, but they were driving by, and they had turned in. And I knew the son that was in the car was crazy about motorcycles. He could tell the name of the motorcycle, how big the engine was, just by listening to the engine. And so he came in, and I said, I asked him, I said, did you see that guy on that motorcycle? You just passed him, you know, it wasn't even 10 seconds. And he said, I never saw a motorcycle, and there was no motorcycle there. And so I think my angel's name is Sandy. But I want to ask you a question now.
Yes.
Tell them the story that you told in San Diego about the guy with the braces, with the suspenders, because I want to try that in my church. Probably about 30 years ago.
This was in this exact same church where he sent me to preach, where this angel was, the exact same one. When we started there, there were only three members still coming to church, and there were nothing was wrong with being over 80, but they were all over 80. And they had no interest whatsoever anymore in anything that was going on in terms of the truth. So he, being the type he was, he went to all the backslidden ones and compelled them to come in. Didn't you do that?
Yeah.
Yes. He went and dug them all up. There was one particular one that was very interesting. He used to throw pans and pots at any Adventist pastor who dared to come. He was married to an Adventist, but he hated Adventists, in particular Adventist pastors, right? And he went to fetch his wife to come also, and then he never does this to anyone really, but he commissioned me to give them a revelation seminar to bring them up to speed, right? It's such a pain. Anyway, here I was, and he sent me, and he said, you only have a very short while to get these backslidden members back on track, because we're having a campaign, and we can't have the people come into nobody, or to nobody believing anything anymore. And so we had prayer meetings, and my wife and I, we prayed with this old lady, one of the three. And we prayed for the campaign. You know how you pray for a campaign. Dear Lord, you know, please help us with this upcoming campaign, and may your spirit work, etc. And it was her turn. And she prayed, dear Lord, please let this campaign be a total failure. We want nobody in this church. We don't need the trouble and the strife and the crisis. Please let no one pitch up. My wife and I, our jaws dropped. Gah. Anyway, she was married to the other man. And that day I had to go and give a campaign, but I'm very pressed for time because I was, you know, I have a job too. I was doing this in my own time. And I had one slot. I don't know how long I had. Let's say I had an hour and 15 minutes or something, then I had to go. And he said, this old elderly gentleman said, he needs to make an announcement. And I said, sure, I'll make your announcement. And he went onto the stage, and I think he was on a diet. He'd lost a lot of weight, and his clothes were from a previous generation when he was a little bit more portulent. But he had what? Show them what he had on. He had braces on.
Suspenders,
you call them, right, to keep his pants up. And there he was, and he gave an announcement. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, and he carried on and on. And my time was going, and I'd driven there all that way to give this thing, and I had to leave, and I wasn't going to be able to do it, and I was stressing. And I didn't want to be rude and go to an old man and say, will you please get off the stage? And so I was sitting there wringing my hands. What do I normally do when I get nervous?
look at your watch.
Oh, yes, that's what I did. I take it off and I frumple it up and I carry on. And then I said, God, please, please get rid of him. And the next second, it went, and all the buttons on his suspenders shut off. And his pants fell like a brick. And he had the weirdest underpants on that you can imagine. It was white with red polka dots on it. He grabbed that pants and ran off that stage. So when this happens these days, I say, Lord, I need that angel.
I'm going to use that now too.
That's a perfect thing. When my elders get a little busy, watch out. I got one of the elders right here.
Just don't go on a diet.
That's right.
Before we start with the questions, we have a baritone that's going to sing to us. If you could come with a pianist. And Dai, would you just tell us who this man is, because you are related. Just come forward and introduce our guest artist. She's always more than willing to address a big audience.
Well, I don't think this baritone has been coerced here. Patrick Stevenson is my father's brother, and I'm honored to have him as an uncle, and he has a beautiful voice. He's one of six sons that have blessed our lives, and many others. Thank you.
You know that Francois was a colporteur when I met him. Can you imagine somebody like him coming to your door and with a set of books that they're going to sell you? He sold lots of books. And so when he asked me to sing, I obviously wasn't expecting it, but I saw that look in his eye, and I gave up. There are wonderful things that you've learned during this week. And I know that the message that you received has been a message about Jesus. But I suspect that there's somebody here today in this crowd, and I'm going to sing to that one person. It's a person who has received a lot of knowledge about a lot of things. But there's this one thing that he or she lacks, and that he or she needs and longs for, and that is for the presence of Jesus in their heart.
The Savior is waiting to enter your heart. Why don't you let him come in? There's nothing in this world to keep you apart. What is your answer to him? Time after time, he has waited before, and now he is waiting again to see if you're willing to open your door. Oh, how he longs to come. If you take one step toward the Savior, my friend, you'll find his arms open wide. Receive him, and all of your darkness will end. Within your heart, he'll abide. Time after time, he has waited before, and now he is waiting again to see if you're willing to open your heart. Oh.